Salam Om Swastiastu, saya salam kebajikan bagi kita semua. Selamat siang dan selamat datang di acara IMCC Class Unraveling the Best Way Mooting for Baby Mooters. Perkenalkan, nama saya Irsyad Alfaizi selaku Master of Ceremony pada event kali ini. IMCC Class merupakan event kedua kepengurusan ILMA pada tahun ini yang ditunjukkan untuk mengenalkan lebih lanjut dan mempraktikkan secara langsung mengenai IMCC. Sebelum memulai acara, demi kelancaran acara, saya akan membacakan tata tertib terlebih dahulu. Seluruh peserta IMCC Class wajib menggunakan format nama sebagai berikut. Untuk member ILSA Chapter UB, member underscore nama. Untuk lembaga organisasi lain, LO underscore nama. Untuk member di luar ILSA Chapter UB, public underscore nama. Seluruh peserta IMCC Class diharapkan berpakaian bebas, rapi, dan sopan. Seluruh peserta IMCC Class diharapkan menyalakan kamera selama acara berlangsung dan menggunakan virtual background yang sudah disediakan. Seluruh peserta IMCC Class diharapkan mematikan mikrofon bila tidak diperlukan dan menjaga kondusifnya kolom chat selama acara berlangsung. Sebelum kita memulai acara pada siang hari ini, ada baiknya kita mengawalnya dengan berdoa terlebih dahulu. Berdoa dimulai. Berdoa tidak akan pernah selesai, namun berdoa dicukupkan. Selanjutnya, kita memasuki ke rangkaian acara berikutnya, yakni sambutan. Sambutan yang pertama akan disampaikan oleh Project Officer IMCC Class kepada Kayla Natasha Eugene. Dipersilakan.
Oke, baik. Terima kasih, Irsyad, kesempatannya. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom, Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya, salam kebajikan bagi kita semua. Yang terhormat Presiden dan Vice Presiden dari ILSA Chapter UB, Kak Ida Ayuvi Pragirindra dan Kak Saskia Awanis. Yang terhormat Speaker dari IMCC Class, Kak Marinka Aniseta Heganavada Simbolot. Yang terhormat para komite serta SPV IMCC Class dan juga para participants yang sudah hadir di acara hari ini. Pertama-tama mari kita panjatkan puji syukur kepada Tuhan Yang Maha Esa yang telah mengizinkan kita semua untuk berkumpul di acara ini, yaitu acara IMCC Class yang mengangkat judul Unraveling the Best Way Mooting for Baby Mooters. IMCC Class merupakan program kerja dari ILSA Chapter UB yang dirancang oleh International Law Moot Affairs atau ILMA dengan tujuan untuk memperkenalkan serta memberikan informasi dan pengetahuan dasar mengenai International Moot Court Competition atau IMCC secara spesifik mengenai memorials dan oral pleadings. Selain itu, IMCC Class juga memberikan kesempatan mengenai bagi teman-teman untuk terjun langsung dalam pembuatan memorials dan juga dalam oral pleading practice. Kami berharap dengan keikutsertaan teman-teman dalam acara hari ini bisa membuka pengetahuan-pengetahuan serta insight-insight baru mengenai IMCC dan kedepannya teman-teman bisa menjadi delegates of IMCC. Saya selaku project officer dari acara hari ini ingin mengucapkan terima kasih kepada semua pihak yang telah terlibat, yang telah bekerja keras dalam acara ini, baik komite, SPV, maupun speaker, sehingga acara IMCC Class bisa terselenggara hari ini. Sekian yang bisa saya sampaikan. Mohon maaf bila ada kekurangan selama keberlangsungan acara. Akhir kata, selamat mengikuti IMCC Class. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom, Om Santi Santi Om, Namo Buddhaya. Salam kebajikan. ILSA, the future of international law. Saya kembalikan ke Irsyad.
Terima kasih, Kayla, atas sambutan hangatnya. Selanjutnya, acara akan dilanjutkan dengan sambutan dari Presiden ILSA Chapter Universitas Brawijaya, Ida Ayuvi Pragirindra. Silakan untuk menyampaikan sambutannya.
Oke, terima kasih, Irsyad. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom, Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya, salam kebajikan untuk kita semua. Jadi, selamat siang semuanya. Sebelumnya, saya ucapkan selamat datang kepada para partisipan IMCC Class pada hari ini. Puji syukur saya panjatkan kehadirat Tuhan Yang Maha Esa karena kita bisa bersama-sama berkumpul dan mengikuti acara IMCC Class pada hari ini. Nah, sebagai salah satu tujuan dari organisasi kami, yaitu untuk turut aktif dalam mempromosikan dan berpartisipasi dalam IMCC, maka dari itu kami, ILSA Chapter UB, khususnya teman-teman dari International Law Moot Affairs, ingin memfasilitasi teman-teman untuk belajar bersama tentang IMCC itu sendiri. Nah, di IMCC Class kali ini, kami mengundang Marinka, yang dimana Marinka ini adalah member dari ILSA, juga tahun lalu sebagai manager dari Competition Management Department, dan di tahun ini menjabat sebagai presiden di Bilstoff. Jadi selain aktif di organisasi, Marinka ini beberapa kali juga ikut aktif dalam IMCC ya, kayak Internation, terus beberapa kali menjadi delegasi di JESAP. Jadi tentunya Marinka ini udah sangat expert ya di IMCC. Jadi seperti yang disampaikan Kayla sebelumnya, di IMCC class kali ini kita mengangkat tema yaitu Unraveling the Best Way Commuting for Baby Mothers. Di mana di sini nantinya kita semua akan belajar lebih dalam tentang IMCC sebagai lanjutan dari IMCC 101 yang sebelumnya. Jadi nanti teman-teman semua akan diajak terjun langsung dalam persiapan IMCC seperti mempelajari mood problem, kemudian tulis memo, kemudian pleading, yang nantinya akan dibimbing secara langsung oleh KKSPV. Jadi dengan diadakannya acara ini, saya harap bisa memberikan ilmu dan dapat meningkatkan minat teman-teman untuk ikut IMCC ke depannya. Jadi sebelum saya buka IMCC kelas hari ini, terakhir saya ucapkan terima kasih kepada Marinka yang udah turut hadir sebagai pemateri. Terima kasih juga kepada teman-teman International Law Mood Affairs yang sudah menyiapkan IMCC kelas ini dengan sebaik mungkin. Dan terima kasih kepada teman-teman peserta yang sudah hadir. Jadi sekian kata sambutan dari saya. Kurang lebihnya mohon maaf. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom, Om Santi, Santi, Santi Om. Salam kebajikan.
Terima kasih Vipra atas sambutannya. Selanjutnya kita akan memasuki main event, tapi sebelumnya saya akan memperkenalkan moderator kita hari ini. Halo Aiga, apakah sudah tersambung?
Halo Irsyad, sudah.
Oke, gimana Aiga kabarnya hari ini?
Alhamdulillah, aku sehat, Irsyad. Gimana Irsyad sendiri?
Alhamdulillah, sehat juga. Oke, sebelum kita lanjut, aku akan membacakan CV dari Aiga supaya para peserta bisa lebih mengenal juga siapa moderator kita kali ini. Aiga adalah manajer dari Merchandise Department di ILSA periode 2020 dan juga pernah menjadi Delegate Namco pada tahun 2021. Untuk selanjutnya, Aiga dipersilakan.
Baik, terima kasih Irsyad. Halo, selamat siang semuanya. Perkenalkan, nama saya Aiga Dwendru Nabila sebagai moderator pada acara hari ini. Sebelumnya, saya ingin mengucapkan selamat datang kepada speaker kita yang sudah hadir pada kesempatan kali ini, yaitu Kak Marinka Aniseta Heganevada Simbolon. Halo Kak Marinka, it's a pleasure to have you today. Gimana kabarnya Kak hari ini?
Hi Aiga, I'm feeling well. How about you?
It's great. I'm pretty well too. Okay, baik. Untuk sesi pertama dalam acara ini akan ada pemaparan materi mengenai IMCC. Sebelumnya izinkan saya untuk membacakan CV materi kita terlebih dahulu. Kak Marinka Aniseta Heganevada Simbolon yang biasa dipanggil Kak Marinka merupakan seorang mahasiswa aktif Fakultas Hukum Universitas Brawijaya sejak tahun 2019. Nah, Kak Marinka sendiri pernah menjadi bagian dari komite ILSA Chapter UB sebagai Manager of Competition Management Department term 2021. Selain itu, beberapa achievements yang telah Kak Marinka raih, diantaranya yaitu pada acara ALSA IMCC, Kak Marinka terpilih sebagai quarter finalist dan top 10 best advocates at preliminary round pada tahun 2021, dan juga pada acara Philip JESAP IMCC, Kak Marinka terpilih sebagai quarter finalist at Asia Pacific Regional Rounds pada tahun 2021 dan Best Applicant Memorial pada tahun 2022. Baik, langsung saja kepada Kak Marinka Aniseta Heganevada Simbolon, dipersilahkan.
Okay, thank you Aiga. So good afternoon everyone. As introduced before, I'm Marinka. Jadi di sini aku bakal mengenalkan apa itu IMCC, specifically in parts of memorial and techniques for oral pleading. Boleh di-share screen slide-nya, panitia? Okay, so as you can see from the screen, there are several international moot court competitions, public and private. Yang public itu ada JESAP and FDI and IHL, while the private one ada CIFIS. CIFIS East and West, yang mana tentang international commercial arbitration. Okay, bisa di next. But I'm not talking about those international moot courts here. I am talking specifically about memorial and also the basic knowledge of oral pleadings as you can see from the screen. Okay, boleh di next, panitia. So before we start, what is memorial? Jadi teman-teman sebelum ikut kompetisi IMCC, sebelum oral pleading stage, you are required to submit a memorial. Nah, memorial ini adalah documents containing submissions or arguments intended to persuade the court. Jadi, your arguments is specifically intended to persuade the court that your side should win on the basis of facts and law. Nah, the other function of the memorial itself is to fulfill your obligation. Jadi, teman-teman, memo ini wajib untuk disubmit ke court, whether it's ICJ atau ICC or arbitral tribunal, they all required a memorial before you plead your case. Oke, boleh di next. Jadi salah satu contoh kenapa memorial ini wajib buat disubmit ada di Article 49 of ICJ's Rules of Court, di mana memorial itu shall contain a statement of the relevant facts, a statement of law, and the submissions. Oke, boleh di next. Oke, jadi memorial ini punya beberapa parts, which I divided into two. First is essential part, and second is additional part. Jadi yang apa sih yang harus ada di memo pada umumnya? Itu adalah cover page. Jadi cover page itu adalah introduction, which side are you taking, your team number, and yeah, basically the introduction. And then the table of contents. Jadi itu daftar isi, isi dari keseluruhan memorial kalian. And then there's index of authorities, di mana index of authorities ini berisi semua list sources yang kalian pakai untuk menulis memorial. And then ada table of abbreviations. Table of abbreviations ini isinya singkatan. Misalnya ICJ, kalian ditulis keterangan dari situ, misalnya International Court of Justice. And this mainly the function is for guidance to the judges later on. And then the most important part is arguments presented or pleadings. And then the last one, prayer for relief. Okay, and then there's additional part. Additional part ini nggak selalu ada dalam memo, tapi beberapa moot court seperti JASAP mungkin, atau IHL, atau FBI, require this part to in order to guide the judges later while they're assessing your memorial. Ada statement of facts. Jadi statement of facts ini nggak semata-mata kalian kopas apa yang ada di moot problem. No. Statement of facts ini must be persuasive. Telling a story, telling your case based on your perspective. Whether you're applicant, you tell the story from the applicant's perspective, or when you're taking the side of a respondent, you tell the story from the respondent's point of view. And then the statement of jurisdiction. Statement of jurisdiction ini basically adalah keterangan di mana kalian stated that the court has jurisdiction based on what. And then questions presented. Questions presented ini adalah prayer for relief, tapi dalam bentuk kalimat tanya. And then summary of pleadings, yaitu penjelasan singkat tentang pleading kalian, tentang your argument. Okay, next. Okay, jadi bagian paling pentingnya adalah how to compose a memorial. Jadi teman-teman pasti dalam menyusun you are required to follow some steps in order to make your memorial more structural, and then the judges and of course your team as well could understand what are you writing or what are the arguments presented in your memorial. So the first and most important step is create an outline and roadmap. Whatever you call it, whether you want to call it outline or roadmap, it's up to you. It consists of your thesis or subthesis. Jadi apa sih di sini maksudnya thesis atau subthesis? It's basically your main idea. What do you want to argue? Garis besarnya apa yang mau kalian argue in your memorial? What is the function of an outline? It basically helps you to understand the flow of your argument or your train of thoughts. Jadi dengan adanya outline, basically you have guidelines on how to compose your arguments, how to structure your argument. Jadi ini karena dengan adanya outline ini kalian nggak akan lost di tengah-tengah. Seringkali kesalahan-kesalahan pada umumnya adalah mooters itu lupa bikin outline. They're just basically write anything that they want, tapi di tengah jalan mereka lost. They don't know anymore what to write. Jadi, outline ini berfungsi sebagai guideline, di mana ketika kalian lost sekalipun, kalian bisa go back to the outline. You can go back to your main idea. And then, this outline juga akan berfungsi untuk bantu kalian di oral reading. So, keep your outline from the very beginning until the end of the mid-court competition. Okay, boleh di next? Okay. One thing to remember while making an outline or making a roadmap or memorial as a whole is IREC. IREC is basically issue, regulation, application, or conclusion. Sebelumnya di sini teman-teman ada yang pernah dengar nggak istilah IREC? Maybe for those of you who just started your meeting competition or mungkin teman-teman Ilsa yang udah pernah ikut on RISE, kalian pasti diajarin apa itu IREC. IREC ini adalah structure yang harus kalian ikuti kalau mau memori kalian terstruktur. Jadi, IREC ini basically adalah bentuk terstruktur dari argumen kalian. You can use it on your memorial and later on your oral reading. Okay, boleh di next. Okay, let's start with issue. Issue itu adalah something you are trying to prove. Apa sih yang mau kamu buktikan in front of the court? What is the issue of your case? What kind of problem do you want to argue? So for example, ini dari mood problem JASAP tahun ini yang kemarin. So it's basically talking about order of suspension intended to suspend someone's right towards freedom of expression. So the issue from the point of view of the applicant was the order of suspension issued towards a certain person here named Professor Hanlon was necessary. Okay, that's the issue. That is what you want to argue in your memorial. And then next, after you identify the issue, after you found it, you basically have to know what kind of legal basis do you want to use. Jadi, legal basis ini, it could take a form of convention or treaty or customary international law, for example, or maybe a case law or articles, comments from the UN or from the ICJ or from another institutions that issued the treaty. So for example, I took Article 19, paragraph 3 of ICCPR, which provides that restriction towards freedom of expression, other than provided by law, must be necessary to fulfill its legitimate aims, namely to protect national security. And this has been reaffirmed by the HRC in General Comment Number 36. The HRC establishing a direct and immediate connection between the expression and the threat as criteria for the necessity test. Okay, that's the regulation. First, you identify the issue, and then you found the regulation. Next, you have to apply the law to the case, to your case. Remember, hukumnya itu nggak bakal berguna kalau kalian nggak punya application-nya. If you don't know how to apply the law, then it might be useless. So the application is basically how would the rules apply to your present case, or basically how you would interpret the rules. So for example, I interpret it as follows. Professor Hanlon's post threatened national security and public order, as such posts contain misinformation which incites to violence. They have a direct and immediate connection threatening the referendum, since they were likely to undermine the inviolability of the referendum and to incite imminent violence. So basically in this case, Professor Hanlon itu create a false information, jadi dia post in a social media, and then such post creates public disorder, karena at that time, mereka tuh akan melaksanakan referendum. And those false information will threaten the referendum. So that's how you apply the law, how you apply the regulation as presented before. And then the conclusion. So the conclusion is you wrap up all the issue, regulation, and then the application, and making it the upshot of your analysis. What do you want to achieve? What do you want the court to declare? Is the order of suspension is necessary since it fulfilled the necessity test as required by the regulation before? Okay, so that is the IREC. But remember, IREC itu nggak bakal selamanya IRAC. Bisa aja dia dalam bentuk RAC atau bisa IAC. It depends on the situation of your argument. It depends on how you construct your memorial. Jadi IREC ini nggak strict. But you have to follow the steps in order to make your memorial more structured. Okay? Jadi sometimes the issue is finished. So you only have to explain the regulation, the application, and the conclusion of your case. Or maybe the issue and the regulation is finished so that you only have to explain your application and then the conclusion. Dan IREC ini juga adalah sesuatu yang tricky. Kenapa aku bilang tricky? Sometimes you cannot differentiate it between the issue and the conclusion, for example. Or maybe you cannot differentiate between the regulation and the application. How to overcome that? Make sure you identify those I, R, A, and C well. Okay? And then after the outline and the IREC, you have to fill in the arguments. Tadi kan kalian udah punya outline. Tadi kalian udah punya IREC-nya juga. Ya udah tinggal susun. Sesuai dengan urutan yang tadi. But you have to be careful in choosing the words. Again, memorial was intended to persuade the court that your side should win. Jadi, how to persuade the courts? Use persuasive words. Remember the purpose of your arguments. And then apply it to your argument. Okay, jadi, choosing the words is one of the most important thing in writing a memorial. And salah pilih kata aja, it could twist your own argument dan bisa jadi bumerang ke kalian. So you have to pay attention to that as well. And then we have legal basis sources. Buat teman-teman yang udah belajar hukum internasional pasti tahu ya, Article 38, Paragraph 1 of ICJ Statute. Article 38, Paragraph 1, specifically, nggak punya hierarki. You can use all the sources, mau berurutan atau enggak, terserah. Itu enggak ada hierarkinya. But again, we divide it into primary sources and secondary sources. Maksudnya gimana? Primary sources itu bisa berdiri sendiri, teman-teman. Kayak international conventions, atau customary international law and general principles of law. Tapi secondary sources ini enggak bisa berdiri sendiri. You have to support secondary sources with the primary sources. For example, you find a case law, basically talking about the principle of non-intervention, Nicaragua case, misalnya. And then you support it with those primary sources, the international conventions. What kind of conventions talk about the principle of non-intervention? For example, Article 2, Paragraph 4 of the UN Charter. Okay, jadi, while primary sources bisa berdiri sendiri, secondary sources itu enggak. And you have to specifically pay attention to the secondary sources, because it has to be form of international judicial decisions. Again, international judicial decisions. Jadi, mau decision dari ICJ, dari International Arbitral Tribunal, as long as it is an international judicial decisions made by an international court, you can use it as secondary sources. And then, academic writing from highly qualified publishers. Yang kedua ini agak tricky, karena what defines as highly qualified publicist adalah the International Law Commission. Kalau kalian tahu, International Law Commission itu adalah yang buat RCWA, yang nge-issue Yearbook of International Law. Jadi, what defines as highly qualified publicist itu adalah mereka di dalam legal basis sources. Tapi bukan berarti kalian nggak bisa gunain kayak journals or articles di dalam submission kalian. Again, you have to be careful because all those secondary sources must be supported by primary sources. Okay, boleh di next. Ya, jadi part sebelumnya adalah tentang memorial. And then I have to explain to you basic knowledge of pleading. Jadi sebelum pleading, you have to make sure that you masters all your arguments in your memorial. Kenapa gitu? Karena kalian bakal oral pleading. If you don't master your argument, kalian mau bawa apa ke courtnya? Jadi, how to deliver a great presentation in your oral pleading is first and foremost IREC. Aku nggak bakal bosan-bosan buat ingetin tentang IREC because this is very important. IREC itu akan dipakai dari mulai awal kalian mulai meeting sampai kalian di akhir. Okay? Jadi oral pleading, basically the way you presented your arguments in front of the panels must follow the structure of the IREC. First, you deliver the issue, and then the regulation, the application, and then the conclusion. Okay. Mungkin kalian bakal bertanya-tanya, Kak, gimana sih kalau misalnya ditanyain sama judges-nya? Sometimes orang-orang yang ditanya sama judges itu akan lose the track. Apalagi, especially when you meet hot bench judges. Okay? Jadi, karena loss, akhirnya ini nggak diingat lagi. No, don't do that. Just remember that you have to remember the IREC while presenting your arguments, while answering the questions, because that is important, teman-teman. Yang dilihat dari pleading itu bukan cara kalian ngomong, bukan karakter kalian, no. They want to know gimana sih cara kalian master your argument, and gimana cara kalian menjawab every questions from the judges. This is the most important thing you have to keep in mind. And then, salah satu cara lain untuk biar kalian nggak lose track adalah create an outline or roadmap instead of full text scripts. This will help you to become more flexible. Jadi, meeting ini, it's all about flexibility. You have to be flexible while pleading, karena you'll never know what happens. You'll never know the questions. Kalian mungkin bisa practice. You spend months and months practicing with your teammates, with your coaches. But if you're not flexible, and itu all those practices itu jadi useless. Kenapa gitu? Karena sometimes you will receive unexpected questions, for example. Mungkin pertanyaannya ini udah pernah kalian latih, tapi kata-katanya beda, ditwist sama judges. Atau pertanyaan ini memang sama sekali nggak pernah kalian dapat. Jadi, the way you overcome the pressure is by being flexible. Ingat, kalian punya outline, kalian punya roadmap. You have basically the structure of your plan instead of full text script. Karena kalau misalnya kalian bawa full text script yang benar-benar dari A sampai Z, apa yang mau kalian bilang ada di teks itu, kalian akan terpaku sama script. Kalian bakal jadi kaku. Dan gak akan ada lagi ruang buat kalian flexible in answering or presenting to the judges. Jadi, dengan adanya outline ini, it shows that you master your argument. Di sini kalian bukan hafal mati. Di sini, you have to present your argument to the panels, to the judges. Judges itu, mereka gak akan baca mood problem mungkin, atau mungkin mereka nggak akan pay attention ke kalian dari mulai awal sampai akhir, no. So the best thing to get their attention is by having a conversation with the court, and that's why you have to be flexible. Jadi, dengan adanya outline ini atau roadmap ini, kalian bisa lebih santai ataupun lebih kayak conversation while delivering your arguments. Kalau misalnya full text, kalian akan terpaku sama teksnya, whether you save it on your computer, for example, atau kalian print, dan kalian nggak punya kontak dengan judges-nya. You don't make any eye contact, for example. Atau mungkin kalian nggak, jadinya nggak kayak conversation, kalian kayak baca aja gitu. Jadi, outline and roadmap, of course, with IREC structure, is important, and you should use this instead of full text scripts. And then the third and the most important thing again is practice, practice, and practice. Teman-teman, meeting itu nggak hanya kalian practice satu malam langsung jadi, langsung bisa pleading, no. It requires months of practice. Mungkin kalian harus latihan tiap hari. Because you have to improve. Tiap hari itu ada aja yang harus diimprove, ada aja yang harus diperbaiki, ada aja yang harus you have to pay attention so that during the real pleading, kalian bisa overcome those situations. Jadi, practice is really important. practice makes perfect, right? Jadi tanpa adanya practice ini, semua yang udah kalian siapin itu ya useless. Mooting is all about practice. Mooting itu bukan tentang orang yang pintar, bukan tentang orang yang bikin argumen aja jago. No, it's all about practice. Apa gunanya punya argumen jago? Apa gunanya punya skill yang bagus kalau kalian gak practice? Gitu. Boleh di next? Okay, and the last part of my presentation is possible questions during. First is legal standing. Jadi ada kasus di mana kalian harus bisa jawab, what is your legal standing? For example, ada orang, dia warga negara lain, tapi warga negara, misalnya ada negara A dan B. Warga negara B melakukan kejahatan di negara A. Jadi negara A bawa kasusnya ke Mahkamah Internasional, ke ICJ. Dan kamu tiba-tiba negara C, out of nowhere, join their case. What is your legal standing then? Kenapa kamu bela misalnya si warga negara B ini? What is your legal standing? Is it because of erga omnes obligation? Or what? So you have to pay attention this legal standing. Karena kamu harus punya alasan kenapa kamu membela a certain person, for example, or a certain state. And then the other important and basic question is why the court has jurisdiction over the case. Kenapa sih court ini berwenang mengadili kasus kalian? This could be tricky. Beda-beda tipis sama legal standing. Tapi basically, the second question talks about jurisdiction. Kenapa court harus mengadili kasus kalian? Why the court has jurisdiction? Apa dasarnya? Is it because of the special agreement, Article 36, Paragraph 1, ICJ Statute? Atau compulsory jurisdiction, Article 36, Paragraph 2. You have to know exactly why the court has jurisdiction over your case. That is important, teman-teman. Istilahnya gini, kalian datang ke court tapi kalian nggak tahu mau ngapain di situ. That would be ironic. So those two questions, pay attention to them. And then the facts. Kalian harus, you have to master all the facts. Ya? Yeah? Karena apa? Karena facts ini adalah basically you apply all the regulations to the facts. Gimana sih faktanya? What happened in your case? That would be ironic if you don't master the facts. Bakal sangat susah ketika kalian tidak mengetahui atau kalian tidak menguasai fakta yang ada di kasus kalian ketika kalian oral pleading. Karena apa? Karena ya gimana kalian mau argue kalau kalian gak tahu faktanya kayak gimana? Itu bakal jadi bumerang kalau kalian gak tahu apa faktanya. Jadi, make sure you master the facts. Mungkin kalian bisa hafal atau mungkin kalian dalam praktis bisa ngadain kayak semacam quiz kecil-kecilan gitu antara teammates to know exactly what the facts are. Dan fakta ini bukan hanya specifically tentang apa argumen kalian, no. You have to know every single facts presented in the moot court. And then the regulations or the case laws. So be careful while using a certain regulations or a certain case law. Make sure that's relevant. For example, kasus kalian tentang cyberspace. Tapi kalian pakai case law tentang, for example, Nicaragua case, military and paramilitary activities. Enggak apple to apple kan? Enggak relevant. So you have to make sure that every case law, every regulations, every treaty that you use during your pleading itu relevant dengan kasus kalian. Bakalan aneh kalau misalnya kasus kalian tentang human rights in cultural expressions. Tapi kalian pakai human rights buat IHL, for example. That would not be relevant. So you have to pay attention, you have to master the law, okay? Karena mooting is all about the facts and the law. The facts come first and then the law. And the last thing is basic international law knowledge. Jadi jangan lupa, kalian mungkin udah belajar banyak regulation, you master all the case laws, the facts, tapi kalian lupa basic international law. Sesimpel sumber-sumber hukum internasional aja. Atau mungkin sesimpel pengertian what is international law, for example. So you don't you dare to forget the basic. Jadi any possible questions during reading? Mungkin kalian bakal bertanya-tanya gimana sih buat tahu kalau misalnya ini question tentang the facts or maybe it's a question tentang regulations. Pay attention to what the judges say. Pay attention to the wording that they use. Karena mereka bisa kasih pertanyaan panjang-panjang, but you have to find the main point of their questions. Is it the facts, the regulations? So you have to, it is required a critical thinking, teman-teman, to identify what kind of questions the court asking you during your reading. Okay, I think that's all of my presentation. May it please the court, and I would be so pleased if you ask other questions. Maybe aku lebih prefer buat menerangkan ataupun menjelaskan sesuatu melalui question and answer. That will be direct and that will be useful for all of you. So, or if you have any further inquiries, you can contact me through email or LinkedIn. Thank you. Aku kembalikan lagi ke moderator.
Baik, terima kasih Kak Marinka untuk pemaparannya yang sangat baik tentang Get to Know IMCC. Mulai dari apa itu memorial, langkah-langkah menyusun memorial menggunakan sistem IREC, apa saja bentuk legal basis sources, basic knowledge, dan juga possible questions during pleadings-nya. Nah, kemudian teman-teman, selanjutnya kita akan masuk ke sesi yang paling ditunggu-tunggu juga nih, yaitu sesi tanya-jawab. Jadi, bagi teman-teman yang memiliki pertanyaan, bisa langsung raise hand dan on mic, lalu sampaikan pertanyaannya. Atau juga bisa dengan mengetik pertanyaannya di kolom chat box yang tersedia, dan saya sebagai moderator akan membacakannya. Nah, yuk langsung buat teman-teman yang penasaran mengenai apapun tentang IMCC. Jangan malu-malu. Nah, nih, udah ada 2 orang. Wah, 3 orang nih yang udah raise hand. Aku mulai dari yang raise hand duluan ya, dari Gilang. Mungkin Ananda Gilang boleh langsung on mic.
Okay, thank you moderator Aiga for the opportunity and thank you very much Marinka for the insightful presentation. I have 2 questions actually. The first question is in regards to the regulation that you mentioned in the IREC structure. So in a public law, in a public law with court, we can use like treaties or customary international laws, as you've mentioned before. But I'm curious about what kind of regulation used for private law with court. Could it be a contract between 2 countries or I think that's the first question. And the second one is about the IREC. So you mentioned as well in the presentation that use IREC as a guidance every single time. So what does that mean? Does that mean in a single pleading document, you can use more than 1 IREC structure? Or is my question clear?
Okay, moderator, can I directly answer the question atau nunggu semuanya nangin?
Boleh langsung dijawab ke Kamarinka.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, for the first one you've already mentioned, Gilang. Jadi private international law itu ada yang berbeda. Sources of international law itu ada yang beda. Jadi kalau misalnya untuk public, you have Article 38, Paragraph 1 of ICJ Statute kan. So basically in private moot court, for example, this. You have the contract between 2 parties. You have the seat of arbitration, or maybe in the foreign direct investment route, you have the bilateral investment treaty, the BIT, and you have also the seat of arbitration. You also have, you can also use the principles of law as well. And then you have the agreement between the parties again, because that is essential for a private moot, right? Because it's a private, you required contract. So basically sama, tapi yang bedanya itu, ada contract, ada seat of arbitration, ada arbitration rules dari institusinya, whether it's UNCITRA rules, or ICSID rules, or SIAC rules, it's an additional sources for the private moot court. And then for the second question, basically di setiap arguments in your memorial, mau itu claim A, B, C, D, the structure of the IRAP itu sama. But you don't have to follow the strict IRANC again. Karena bisa aja nih, di poin A, you've already talked about the issue and regulation. And then you want to talk about the application and the conclusion in point B, that's okay. Gitu. Jadi, yang penting dia berurut. Gitu. Walaupun misalnya dia nggak ada isunya, tapi yang regulation, the application and the conclusion itu harus tetap berurut. In every parts of your memorial, in your argument. Gitu. I hope that answers your question, Gila.
Thank you, Marinka.
Oke, okay, thank you Kak Marinka dan juga Gilang untuk pertanyaannya. Kemudian mungkin aku bisa lanjutkan ke yang udah raise hand selanjutnya, yaitu Sakif Givari. Boleh langsung bertanya, Sakif?
Oke, okay. Halo Kak Marinka. Jadi Kak, aku mau nanya, simpel aja. Kan tadi kan kita dibilang, ada yang namanya itu jurisdiction over the court. Nah itu maksudnya gimana ya Kak? Maksudnya jurisdikasi. Kan maksudnya tadi kan kita bicara tentang ICJ. Emang ada berapa court sih Kak yang mengadili hukum internasional ini, dan apakah itu ada batas-batasannya seperti itu? Terima kasih.
Okay, so International Court of Justice is the court that adjudicate case between states. Jadi hanya negara dengan negara. Okay? Nah, jurisdiction is basically why a certain party is brought the case before the court. Kalau di Article 36, Paragraph 1, it's through the special agreement. Jadi, both parties, dia tuh nggak accept the jurisdiction of the ICC, a compulsory jurisdiction. They did not make a compulsory jurisdiction or a statement stating that they accept the jurisdiction. So they made it through the special agreement. Special agreement itu adalah sebagaimana dikatakan di Article 36, Paragraph 1 of ICJ statute adalah agreement between both parties that they agreed to settle their dispute yang bakal dirinci di special agreement itu to the ICJ. And then you have compulsory jurisdiction, Article 36, Paragraph 2. Compulsory jurisdiction. So through compulsory jurisdictions, the court has jurisdiction towards any interpretation of a treaty, any questions of the law, breach of an international obligation, and then the reparation. Kalian mungkin udah diajarin di kelas juga tentang how the International Court of Justice has jurisdiction. Jadi through the special agreement and then through the compulsory jurisdiction. Jadi itu untuk specifically untuk ICJ. And kalau untuk court lain, misalnya, for example, International Criminal Court, it adjudicate case regarding pidana internasional, for example. Or maybe you have the arbitral tribunal. Jadi arbitral tribunal itu tentang arbitrase. For example, the exit tribunal tentang foreign direct investment. Tiap court, every court has their own rules, and in each rules they specifically address what kind of matters, in which cases do they have jurisdiction. Gitu Sakit. Jadi nggak bisa disamain. Every court has their own different jurisdiction. Kamu nggak mungkin bawa kasus misalnya tentang pidana internasional ke arbitrase. Sebenarnya bisa-bisa aja, tapi kan ada pengadilan lebih berwenang lagi kayak ICC, atau mungkin the questions regarding a trade law biasanya bawanya ke arbitrase. Kalau di ICJ, as long as it falls under their jurisdiction, mau masalah HAM mungkin atau masalah tentang pelanggaran sovereignty or violation of principle non-intervention, as long as it is about international law, and as long as the parties are states, maka ICJ punya jurisdiction. Okay, it's a different case with different courts.
Baik, apakah cukup untuk jawabannya, Sakif?
Baik, cukup-cukup. Terima kasih, Kak.
Oke, terima kasih juga Sakif atas pertanyaannya. Terima kasih Kak Marinka. Selanjutnya mungkin kita bisa ke next person, yaitu di sini ada Glory Silviana. Boleh langsung, Glory.
Oke, terima kasih kesempatannya moderator. Saya mau bertanya kepada ke Kak Marinka terkait leading, Kak. Pada saat leading itu, apabila judges memberikan kita pertanyaan, sebenarnya ada opsi untuk kita tidak menjawab pertanyaan apabila kita misalnya lagi ngeblank, mungkin kita nggak tahu nih mau jawab apa. Menurut kakak, yang paling fatal itu apakah kita sama sekali tidak menjawab, atau kita menjawab pertanyaan tetapi tidak menjawab dengan benar gitu, jadi nggak akurat, Kak, jawabannya. Menurut Kak Marinka, mana yang lebih fatal? Terima kasih.
Oke, aku langsung jawab. Menurut aku yang paling fatal itu bukan dua-duanya. Paling fatal adalah if you try, kalau kamu mencoba menipu judges. There's a certain case di mana kalian nggak tahu mau jawab apa. And then you choose to cheat. Dan kamu milih untuk menipu mereka. Okay. Mungkin kamu ngira, ah mereka bukan orang yang berkecimpung di international law. Ya udah tipu-tipu aja, karang-karang aja jawabannya. No, don't do that. Mau judges itu, they come from various background, right? Tapi mereka bisa tahu kalau kamu nipu. Kalau kamu, when you made up the answer. So if you really don't know what to answer, jangan coba-coba buat nipu. You can do first, minta waktu sebentar. If I may have a moment, your absences, for example. Atau, if you already have that moment, tapi kalian tetap gak nemu. Kalian bisa bilang, apologies, your absences. Due to the extent of our research, we are unable to assist you with this question. That would be the best, instead of making up answers. Dan kalaupun misalnya kalian nggak tahu mau jawab apa nih, you have 4 chances to play. Ada 4 preliminary round. You can just simply write down the questions, and then maybe if you cannot answer it in your current reading, for your next reading, try your best to research on this question and answer that. Okay. The most important thing is don't make up any answers. Karena mereka pasti tahu. Mereka pasti tahu waktu kalian coba untuk bikin jawaban sendiri ngarang. Because maybe nggak semua orang bakal ketemu judges yang kayak gini ya. But I've met judges. Yang dimana aku bilang apa? She research. She search what I say. She search the regulation. So there's no way I could make up my answers, right? Jadi, instead of making up answers, lebih bagus you took a moment to think, or you could simply ask her to rephrase her question. Karena bisa aja pemilihan katanya dia itu susah buat kamu pahami. So ask him or ask her or ask them to rephrase the question to make it simple for you.
Baik, terima kasih Kak Marinka. Apakah sudah cukup jawabannya, Glory?
Sudah cukup menjawab. Terima kasih Kak Marinka.
Baik. Untuk selanjutnya mungkin kita lanjut ke Lidwina. Boleh silakan on mic, Lidwina.
Baik, terima kasih atas kesempatannya. Aku mau nanya Kak Marinka, bagaimana tips dari Kak Marinka untuk menemukan legal basis yang pas untuk suatu kasus atau mood problem gitu? Dan apa kita perlu untuk memahami semua legal basis source-nya dulu atau gimana? Terima kasih.
Oke, jadi in order to find a correct legal basis, paling pertama itu adalah identify the problem. Jadi sebenarnya masalahnya ini apa? Misalnya masalahnya tentang human rights, ICCPR. And then I found, oh, I have to use ICCPR, for example. Which article? Nah, nanti while I was researching for the legal basis, ketemu nih artikelnya. And then apply the regulations to the issue you've just found. Tapi make sure, jangan satisfied karena kalian udah ketemu nih, misalnya kalian ngerasa kalau itu tepat. sampai kalian lupa untuk research more and more and more. Jadi jangan, kalau tips dari aku sih sebenarnya jangan cari legal basisnya dulu. Cari dulu problemnya apa, baru cari legal basisnya. And then the research bakal ngikutin flow-nya dari apa yang udah kalian temukan. Dan buat research, here's the tip. Kalian kalau misalnya research, don't forget to make the points of what you're researching. Jadi misalnya hari ini nih, kalian research tentang violation of human rights to move problem kalian. Catat aja kalian ketemu regulations apa, kalian ketemu case law apa, kalian ketemu isunya apa tadi. And then try to apply it to the issue. Jangan, don't forget to take notes of your research every single time. Karena ketika misalnya nih kalian lupa nih kemarin researchnya apa, you can always go back to the notes. You can always go back to what you've researched the day before. Dan ini juga buat jaga-jaga untuk misalnya nih komputer kalian rusak terus semua researchnya hilang. If you have that note specifically, kalian tahu bakal kembali kemana to continue your research. Atau kalau misalnya di oral reading nih, kalian butuh guidance nih, kayak aduh lupa nih kasusnya tentang apa. Misalnya si judge-nya nanya, Pulp Mills itu kasus tentang apa? Terus kalian lupa. Dengan adanya notes tadi yang mungkin kalian bisa bikin jadi handbook, kalian tahu jawabannya ada di situ. Karena itu ya bekas bahan research kalian. Jadi gitu, Lidina.
Baik, terima kasih Kak udah jawab.
Oke, baik. Terima kasih Kak Marinka atas jawabannya, dan terima kasih juga Lidwina atas pertanyaannya. Mungkin ada lagi teman-teman yang ingin bertanya, bisa langsung raise hand dan okay. Aku bantu membacakan. Di sini sudah ada pertanyaan dari Raita. Halo Kak, sebelumnya maaf belum bisa on cam. Saya Raita dari Universitas Brawijaya yang bertanya, apa ada tips dari Kakak untuk menemukan kata-kata yang baik dan benar dalam penyusunan memorials, terutama kalau kita belum terlalu mahir dalam bahasa Inggris? Terima kasih Kak sebelumnya.
Oke, pemilihan kata ya. Jadi sekarang tuh kayak moot court tuh lebih gampang ya. Online, banyak site yang kalian bisa temukan. You can use misalnya Quillbot atau Grammarly to misalnya for to rephrase the words atau to find a certain words ya. Karena legal English is a whole different English from apa yang udah kita pelajari selama ini. Jadi tipsnya adalah you can use that Quillbot, Grammarly, or dictionary yang Black Law Dictionary, for example, untuk menemukan kata-kata yang tepat untuk memo kalian. And remember, dalam nyusun kata-kata itu, make sure that it's a whole persuasive word and suits your point of view, whether as applicant or as respondent. Jadi kalian bisa manfaatin aplikasi, bisa manfaatin kamus kayak Quillbot tadi atau Grammarly tadi. Jadi untuk sekarang ya nggak sesusah itu deh untuk menemukan kata-kata yang baik dan benar. And you have your friends, right? Jadi kalian bisa saling check and recheck untuk correct every single word in your memorial. And then you have coaches juga. Don't hesitate to ask your coaches, karena nggak semua orang mungkin bahasa Inggrisnya lancar dan kita pun masih belajar. So you don't have to worry kalau misalnya bahasa Inggrisnya nggak lancar atau mungkin kalian masih tersendat-sendat ngomongnya. That's okay. Ada banyak platform yang bisa membantu kalian, and of course you have your friends, your teammates, and your coaches as well.
Baik, terima kasih Kak Marinka atas jawabannya. Teman-teman, berhubungan dengan keterbatasan waktu, sayang sekali sepertinya sesi tanya-jawab harus dicukupkan. Sebelumnya, saya sebagai moderator hari ini ingin mengucapkan terima kasih kepada Kak Marinka atas pemaparannya yang sangat baik dan juga ilmu yang bermanfaat mengenai IMCC. Berikutnya, kita akan lanjut ke sesi workshop. Nah, pada sesi workshop kali ini, teman-teman akan melakukan praktik dalam pembuatan memorial, tapi tenang aja karena teman-teman akan dipandu oleh kakak SPV-nya masing-masing. Setelah ini, teman-teman akan di-invite ke dalam breakout room. Diharap semua dapat memasuki breakout room yang telah ditentukan oleh panitia. Selamat berproses di breakout room semuanya. Semangat!
Kak, mau nanya deh. Nanti SPV-nya langsung share screen memonya kan ya?
Ya, pokoknya itu diserahin aja langsung ke
SPV, kakak.
Halo guys, kedengeran nggak ya suara aku?
Kedengeran mau.
Okay. Halo kak, terdengar.
Halo guys. Wait, aku mau share screen ya. Nggak kelihatan bu. Okay, hello guys. Welcome to our workshop session. Jadi ini screen aku kelihatan kan ya?
Iya, kak, udah muncul.
Kelihatan nggak?
Thank you, guys. So, first of all, sebelum kita langsung masuk nih, aku pengen kenalan dulu sama kalian semua. Halo, nama aku Mawar. Aku di sini mahasiswa FHUB juga, dan I'm an ILSA member too. Yeah, so I'm here to guide you all to nyusun memo pertama kita. Gitu. Di sini ada yang mau on mic juga nggak nih kenalan? Or you can just type in the chat kalian nama kalian dan kalian dari mana and why do you nggak deh nggak usah itu kepanjangan tapi kayak nama kalian and kalian dari mana karena aku juga pengen tahu nih or you can turn on your camera too jadi kita biar rame.
Halo kak, kalau aku perkenalannya on mic boleh nggak?
Boleh Nadia.
Iya. Halo, jadi perkenalin nama aku Nadia Indira, bisa dipanggil Nadin. Maaf kak, jadi selain nama harus nyebutin apa lagi?
Dari mana Nadia? Dari UB juga?
Ah iya dari UB dan juga ILSA member. Makasih.
Okay. Thank you Nadine ya dipanggilnya. Okay. Thank you guys. Thank you Nadine for the introduction. And yeah, let's get right to it. Okay. Karena kita waktunya juga terbatas nih. Cuma 40 menit. Jadi tadi kan udah diterangin ya sama Kak Marinka ini. Personally, kita tuh kalau mau bikin memo harus merhatiin dulu nih problemnya gitu. Apa sih yang mau kita bela dan kita di sini harus baca case yang udah dikasih sama court ini gitu kan. Kayak so we know first the problem is terus abis itu baru kita cari regulations. Jadi gini, aku pengen ngasih tahu PPT-nya. Jadi pertama kita cari problemnya, abis itu kita baru kita lihat dan read secara seksama regulations around it, so it can help and benefit our argument. Terus baru abis itu baru kita terjun langsung nyusun memonya. Jadi pertama-tama kita harus baca dulu like what is the problem and there we can review the problem itself. Let me switch the screen first. Okay, so here's our problem. Jadi kalau di mood problem ini sekalian aja breakdown juga lah ya ininya structure-nya. Jadi we got the state parties here and we got the joint notification and the special agreement between the parties. Ini dibuat sebelum mood problemnya ini dijabarkan gitu. Jadi ini kayak agreement between the two parties yang lagi dispute dan ini juga bisa kita baca-baca untuk benefits our conditions for the memo. And yeah, kita baca dulu the special agreement. Yeah. So, ini tuh kemarin udah di distribute belum ya ke participants-nya guys? Buat for the comments.
Udah kok.
Udah ya. If there are udah ada yang baca duluan and you want to tell us briefly about this case, you can turn your microphone on. Terus nanti boleh nyeritain dikit nih gimana sih background case-nya ini. Or kalau malu juga nggak apa-apa di chat. Buat kalau belum juga nggak apa-apa guys, bilang aja belum kak gitu. Nanti biar kita review thoroughly. Oke. Kayaknya langsung aja aku apa kita review thoroughly aja deh bareng-bareng. Jadi background-nya itu ada species called the barrels, right? The barrel is a goat-like sheep, often called the blue sheep. And it originates from the Ibdu Highlands or the Ibdus, mountain ranges spreading from the central part of our first party, which is Andrea. Sorry, okay. Andrea to gimana cara okay. Andrea to the northern part of Rubandi. And then barrels itu mostly live in the peaks of or higher altitudes of the Ibdus, spreading broadly from the central to the southern part of Andrea. Tapi every September, pas seasonsnya lagi change, adult barrels ini travels in the herds of 500 to 400 individuals ke Ibdu yang located to the northern part of Rugandi. So the barrel species ini tuh kayak is a species that lives between the two nation, which is Andrea and Rugandi. Jadi dia nggak netap, and dia ini kalau lagi peaks or higher altitudes, dia tinggal di Andrea, and then pas lagi September terus seasons change, dia tinggal di Rugandi. Mapnya itu bisa kita lihat di annex A, if you guys can see that yourselves. And then, yeah, the barrels ini tuh kayak high-priced commodities. Jadi dia mahal. Dia worth to US $500 to $1,500 per pound. And ya, pokoknya isu utamanya itu yang bisa kita we should remember is that this species lives between two countries, which is Rugandi and Andrea ini. Terus, kita lihat lagi. Jadi kalau lagi baca mood problem gini tuh guys, kita bacanya nggak usah semuanya banget. You can just read it thoroughly. So, you guys know about the method, like read it fast, but every time kalau ada poin penting itu langsung kalian highlight aja gitu, so that way we don't spend too much time reading and focusing on the non-necessary parts of the mood problem. Terus ini ada description about Andrea, the state itself, so that we know more about state Andrea ini. Terus, wait. So, yeah, Andrea is a developing country and dia relies on the trade of its agricultural product. Dan dia juga the first state to trade the barrel species in need to support its economy. So, dia adalah negara yang pertama kali memperjualbelikan si barrel ini buat mensupport state ekonominya dia. Beda lagi dengan Nah, si barrel ini juga means a lot to the suku of Avilians. And yeah, wait, let me read it first, guys. Okay. Yeah. So, akhirnya di Andrea ini kayak the hunting and the trading of the barrel in Andrea is subject to the strict regulation under the 1957 Andrea Barrel Conservation Act, which is a regulation that is meant to support the barrels itself biar nggak punah dan juga tetap ke conserve sama si state-nya ini. And yeah, this is the paragraph yang nge-focus on that regulation to conserve the barrels itself. And then on this side, we have the description for the state of Rugandi, which is the second state in this dispute. It is a coastal state. Jadi negara. Yeah, it is a coastal state with a population of 20 million people. Sedangkan kalau yang Andrea ini kan masih developing. And then Rugandi is a developed country, beda sama si Andrea yang tadi, with a dominant power in trading domestically and internationally, both through land and sea. Nah, si Rugandi ini obtains most of its income by conducting its traditional function as a financial and shipping intermediary for major imports and exports of seafood products, machinery, and crude oil. Jadi beda sama yang Andrea tadi, which relies on its barrel products for its income. Rugandi tuh relies-nya more on seafood products and all of that. So we're getting to the core of the problem here. Jadi kan, as we know, Rugandi is a coastal state that has long relied on trading of seafood products. Tapi, with the increasing pressure buat meragami ekonominya and the rise of the world market, demand, dia tuh harus ngikut demand buat not only have the power for its economy dari seafood aja, tapi juga mereka harus engage akhirnya di perdagangan barrels ini, which involves private sector kayak perusahaan swasta dan juga yang udah di facilitate with the state. Nah, tapi ada kekosongan hukum buat ngeregulasiin hunting dan juga trading dari barrels ini di teritori of Rugandi. Jadi berbeda sama yang Andrea tadi yang udah nge-rely on barrel trade, but they have this regulation, right? Tapi kalau di Rugandi itu ada kekosongan hukum dan jadinya trading and hunting of the barrels became out of control. Then approximately 500 barrels are hunted annually during its migration season. Jadi itu obviously berpengaruh banget ke populasi barrels-nya ini yang tiba-tiba has a decreasing amount, turun jumlah dari species barrels ini for approximately 70,000 from the period of 1993 to 2013. Nah, habis itu ada yang namanya the barrel con- Surfation Foundation ini, yang merupakan State of Andreas Non-Governmental Organization to conserve the barrels, so that barrelsnya ini nggak completely punah. Dan akhirnya mereka angkat bicara tentang the uncontrollable situation that been happening in Burundi. So this is the statements. Ada yang mau bacain nggak? Boleh reaction gitu biar kita sama-sama reviewnya. Atau mau aku tunjuk? Boleh nggak ya kalau aku tunjuk komite? Guys, or ada yang mau voluntarily bacain statementnya ini? Kasas mungkin mau bantu. Or Vanka.
Oke. Mungkin Kasas.
Mungkin Vanka bisa tolong.
Oke. Okay. Dari ini ya.
Dari sini aja.
This past 10 years have been a dark age for the survival of the species of beryl. The species is subject to continuous excessive hunting and trading during its migrating season. The Ipdus is no longer a safe haven for beryls, instead a ruthless hunting zone fueled by man's greed and the lack of proper law and regulations to protect them. In the early 1990s, approximately 120,000 barrels would travel along the Ibus from mountain ranges of Andrea to its slope in Rugandi. This number has sharply declined. As of 2013, there were only 48,000 barrels observed migrating in the Ibus. If this decline were to continue and we do not take any prompt action, that will ultimately result in their extinction. This is a critical time for governments to take necessary measures to protect our barrels.
All right, thank you, Vanka. jadi inti dari statement dari BCF ini, mereka tuh menekankan ada problem. For this past 10 years buat keberadaannya barrels. Jadi in the early 1990s, approximately itu dari 120,000 barrels will travel along the mountain Ipdus from Andrea to Rugandi. Tapi tiba-tiba pas udah di 2013, itu cuma ada 48,000 barrels yang observed migrating from the Ipdus. Nah, jadi kan there is a decreasing amount. Jadi ada pengurangan jumlah yang signifikan dari barrels ini, dan mereka menekankan buat pemerintah-pemerintah, which is the pemerintah of Rugandi and also Andrea, yang memiliki barrel species ini, to conserve it and also protect it gitu, biar mereka nggak extinct. And then, yeah, upon knowing this report, Andrea itu akhirnya merasa sadar nih. Dan mereka akhirnya bikin strict measure in providing licenses to its hunters. Nah, dia juga ask, karena kan si barrels ini nggak live di Andrea aja kan, tapi dia juga live di Rugandi. Akhirnya dia tanya juga buat pemerintahan Rugandi to create the same protection gitu for the barrels. Nah, akhirnya by September 2013 Rugandi itu juga ngikut nih, dia bikin Rugandi Act for the Barrel Conservation or the RBC. Similar juga dia ngikutin juga kayak Andrea, requires pemburu untuk memiliki license buat nge-hunt si barrels. Terus abis itu uncertified hunting tuh bakal ada penaltinya gitu for the Rugandi Criminal Act. Under the Rugandi Criminal Act. And yeah. Nah. Okay. So we have a kind of a long way, so I'm just gonna make it short for you guys. Terus abis itu, at the 11th meeting of the Conference of the Parties to the Convention on the Migratory Species. Jadi si partisnya ini, mereka melibatkan diri kepada Convention on Migratory Species atau konvensi pada species migratory ini for the barrels specifically. Ini juga bisa kita lihat di appendix 1 if you guys want to open it for yourself. And then yeah, ini kedua state-nya meet by video conference the president of Andrea and then the president of Ugandi to talk about the conservation of the barrels. And yeah, yada. And then they pokoknya ngomongin tentang barrels ini kan. Nah, on the next day after the meeting, President Scott itu issued a presidential order to stop all barrel hunting within Rugandi. Jadi, no matter if they have licenses or not, itu nggak boleh ada hunting lagi di Rugandi. Tapi tetap aja itu. Jadi isunya di sini adalah di Rugandi tuh regulation nggak dijalanin dengan benar completely, karena unsupervised and unlicensed hunting itu tetap aja banyak yang nggak dipenalized itu within the Rugandi's government and all that. And yeah. Okay. So terus ada lagi nih di timeline-nya. In January 2018, the government of Rugandi shut down BPP, which is the Blue Ship Program, yang take 10,000 barrels for scientific purposes. Ini dibikin di 2014, and then di stop di January 2018. Tapi karena this program isn't as successful as they thought it would be, ini malah mencederai barrel species lebih lanjut. Jadi, this program has resulted in the death of 1,000 barrels in the facility. So the issue here is that habis itu the Andrea, which is the state yang satu lagi yang also own the barrels, feels like Rugandi has failed to fulfill its international obligation with regards to the conservation of the barrels. So, yeah. Jadi, intinya, after all of this, the state of Andrea dan juga the state of Rugandi has the dispute regarding the barrels, and that Andrea said that Rugandi has failed to fulfill its international obligation with regards to the conservation of the barrels. And on the other side here, Rugandi feels like it has fulfilled its international obligation with regards to the conservation of the barrels. Now, since we are making the applicant memo for this one, is there any of you guys that wanna share your thoughts for this mood problem here? Or why do you guys think that Andrea is right according to this claim? Or kalau ada yang punya opposing thoughts juga nggak apa-apa. You can share your thought first here before we move on to the regulation part. Ada yang mau coba dulu nggak? Nggak apa-apa guys, di chat juga. Or on mic. That would be great. So I know that you guys are kind of reading it with me too tadi. Aku stop share dulu ya. Di sini ada siapa aja yang bukan komite ya. Hi guys. Apa ya? Yaudah deh. Okay. So we're moving on to the regulation aja. Because udah setengah tiga juga ya ternyata. So. In this presentation. Kayak aku ngasih tau kan. Kayak is there any regulations that can help us? Because after kita understand the. Okay, sorry. Okay, so after we understand the problem itself, baru kita bisa baca-baca regulations around it to help us create our argument. Jadi nggak bisa nih kita bikin dulu, kita belum baca, terus tiba-tiba kita udah mau baca-baca regulationsnya sendiri. Because there, kalau kayak gitu, peluang kita buat get lost in our own arguments is more likely than we read the moot court problem first. Okay. So regulations here itu karena tadi problemnya concerning spesies yang bisa dibilang apa ya? in the brink of an extinction, dia juga kan merupakan spesies yang live in two nations, right? So it's a migratory species. Nah, kalau dari regulation itu concerning migratory species, ada namanya convention on the conservation of migratory species or CMS itself. Jadi aku bakal type nih di chat Zoom dan kalian bisa buka masing-masing. Nah. Terus kalian bisa buka masing-masing and then kalau ada pasal yang menurut kalian bisa apa ya namanya, bisa relate to our case tadi, boleh banget dibawa ke forum ini, di chat aja, nanti aku bakal share screen juga pasal berikut, terus bakal aku dia yang bacain guys, terus kita susun bareng-bareng gitu. Okay, guys. Jadi dari yang aku kasih itu, CMS ini, kita share screen aja ya bareng-bareng biar bisa lihat pasalnya juga. This is what I was telling you guys. Jadi ini itu Convention on the Conservation of Migratory Species of Wild Animals. Jadi masih relating to our topic yang di mood problem, si CMS ini tuh banyak yang relating to our argument. Okay. Halo guys, masih di sini kan ya? You guys can boleh nih baca gitu. Jadi ini tuh apa ya, basic banget sih, cuma definition about the migratory species. Jadi biar kita lebih understand juga, for the case of the barrels ini, migratory species itu termnya tuh sebenarnya apa sih gitu, and statusnya ini berdampak apa towards the states that have migratory species and all. Ini aku boleh nunjuk nggak ya ke partisipannya to bacain juga dari regulations ini.
Ya, mungkin aku boleh bacain, Kak.
Okay. Thank you, Ais. Ini kelihatan kan ya screen aku?
Oh iya, kelihatan. Okay. Ini langsung aja untuk yang RA, migratory species means the entire populations or any geographically separate part of the population of any species or lower taxon wild animals, a significant a proportion of whose members cyclically and predictably cross one or more national jurisdiction boundaries. B. Conservation status of a migratory species means the sums of the influence acting on the migratory species that might affect its long-term distributions and abundance. C. The conservation status will be taken as favorable when one is the population dynamics data indicate the migratory species is maintaining itself on a long-term basis as viable component of its ecosystems. Two, the range of the migratory species is neither currently being reduced nor is likely to be reduced on a long-term basis. Three, there is and will be in the foreseeable future sufficient habitat to maintain the populations of the migratory species on a long-term basis. And four, the distributions and abundance of the migratory species approach historic coverage and levels to the extent that potentially susceptible ecosystem access and to the extent consistent with wise wildlife management.
Okay, thank you, Ais. Jadi dari pasal satu ini kan lebih ke interpretation doang kan. Di sini kita tadi yang udah dibacain Ais ini, pasal-pasalnya nge-define what migratory species is, terus conservation status itu apa, dan syarat spesies itu masuk ke conservation status itu seperti apa gitu kan. Jadi kayak populations-nya indicate migratory species itu maintaining itself on a long-term basis dari ekosistemnya, dan juga enggak lagi di-reduce atau enggak lagi dikurangi lah ya dari cara apapun, dan juga ada foreseeable future and sufficient habitat for those following species. Nah, menurut kalian nih, ini tuh apa ya, berlaku nggak sih sebenarnya di state of Rugandi dari mood problem yang tadi kita udah bacain? Kalau dari Ai sendiri gimana nih? Menurut kamu si Rugandi ini nge-fulfill nggak nih semua syarat dari ini buat to protect or to conserve the barrels itself?
Untuk menurut aku, si Rugandi nggak memenuhi hal tersebut, malah lebih membuat apa kayak penyelewengan seperti itu mungkin.
Benar banget, thank you Ais. Yeah, that is exactly what I would say. Karena emang Rugandi ini kan tadi juga kayak walaupun udah ngasih regulation tuh mereka tetap nggak ngehukum, yang tetap ngehunting barrels, terus juga nggak dipenalize apa-apa. Presidennya cuma ngomong okay, dibikin regulation, but penerapannya itu nggak ada, dan it doesn't fulfill the foreseeable future and also the sufficient habitat, karena kemana-mana barrels ini migrate gitu kan, dari Andrea ke Rugandi tiba-tiba dihunt terus and stuff like that. So it can be concluded that Rugandi ini nggak ngefulfill pasal ini dari CMS, and because of that, okay, this is the memo that this is salah satu bahan yang bisa kita masukin ke memo gitu guys. And yeah, jadi itu regulation pertamanya kita dari CMS, and regulation selanjutnya itu kita ada dari PIP ya. Kita ada dari ini aja deh. Wait, sorry. Kita ada dari Arsiwa. So for you guys yang member ILSA, I'm sure you guys are familiar about this Arsiwa stuff. Ini tuh dokumen responsibility of states for internationally wrongful acts. Nah, bentar ya. Wait, okay. Nah, jadi selain Rugandi udah breach the CMS convention dari artikel 1 tadi yang udah dibacain Ais, mereka juga meng violate the article 15 of the responsibility of states, which is the RC1 here. Okay, sorry. Nah, jadi to protect migratory species gitu kan, buat melindungi spesies yang udah jadi kewajiban mereka karena spesies ini tinggal di teritori mereka juga, itu tuh ada hukumnya di internationally. Sorry, bentar. Okay, ya. Yeah. Di internationally the responsibility of states for internationally wrongful act, or we call it RCWA aja. Jadi di artikel 15 ini ada breach yang consisting of a composite act. Ini bisa kita baca di sini, the breach of an internationally obligation, gitu. Kewajiban internasional yang di breach dari state through a series of actions. Jadi nggak cuma sekali dua kali, tapi a series of actions atau kelalaian yang udah berkali-kali terus dilakuin, itu sufficient buat ngomong kalau state itu udah ngelakuin wrongful act. Jadi menurut kalian nih, kita bisa nggak nih pakai ini buat memo? Bisa lah ya, her article 15 ini. Jadi
aku bisa sih kak.
Okay, thank you Ais. So for this one, we are just gonna quote that to our memo. Okay, quote that to our memo. and stuff. Wait. Sebentar ya, guys. Aku stop share dulu biar kita langsung lihat memonya. Wait ya, guys. Jadi ini guys memonya. Kalau memo itu kan, I'm gonna let you guys in on the structure first here. Kalau memo itu berarti kita pertama have this cover, and then ada table of content juga. Di sini aku udah bikin headingnya for you guys to understand. Jadi pertama kan klaimnya emang Andrea ini said that Rubandi has failed to fulfill its international obligation with regards to the conservation of to the barrels gitu kan. Nah ini bisa di breakdown jadi dua subtopic, which is Rubandi was very indecisive in enforcing laws regarding protecting the barrel species. Terus juga BPP program has failed and it has caused death of 1,000 barrel. Ini aku share kali ya linknya, biar kalian juga bisa ikut edit sama aku. Wait, aku copy, terus aku kasih di ini ya, chat zone. Sorry, okay, here. Okay. Bisa akses nggak guys? Bisa kan ya? Okay. Jadi aku udah lumayan nyusun sih guys, biar kalian juga nggak terlalu ribet. Tapi kalau kalian udah mau nambahin juga, bisa langsung klik linknya aja. And you guys can write which of the regulations yang tadi itu atau mood problem yang menurut kalian bisa masuk ke memo ini. Jadi kan tadi kan udah dibilang tuh ada structure paragraph or argument itu ada IRAC kan. Jadi issue, regulation, application, and conclusion. So this we are addressing the issue first. According to the paragraph 8 of the mode problem, Rubandi was involved in the barrel trading gitu, without any proper regulation. This is the issue that we are addressing, dan juga ini adalah yang kita mau tekanin sebagaimana ini subtopik kita pertama. Yang pertama, gitu. Kiaro Gandhi was very indecisive in enforcing laws regarding to protect the barrel species. Regarding to protect. The barrel species, okay. So, bisa kalian baca di sini. Ais, can you help me read this again? Or is there any volunteer yang mau baca juga tentang this issue that we are addressing first?
Bisa aku bantu baca, Kak?
Okay, thank you, Ais.
According to paragraph 8 of the meat problem, Uganda was involved in the barrel trading without any proper regulations, causing uncontrolled hunting at a decreasing amount of approximately 700,000 barrels from 1993 to 2030, only until September 2013. Uganda enacted an act that requires hunters to attain a hunting license, but there was no clarity regarding the time, the limit of the license, and the annual hunting limit.
Okay, thank you, Ais. So, that is the issue that we are addressing, dan itu juga udah ada di mood problem. Jadi kalau kalian lagi masusun memo, itu kita masukin dulu. We can quote this directly gitu, langsung copy paste aja dari mood problemnya, atau kalian bisa parafrase sendiri in your own words to make your argument stronger. Nah, abis itu baru kalian footnotein, and kalau footnote mood problem tuh kalian masukin kompromi dan paragraf berapa yang kalian maksud dari poin itu. Nah, because there's the issue that we are addressing, abis issue comes regulations from the IREC structure. Terus regulations-nya itu yang tadi udah aku jelasin atau kita baca bareng-bareng juga dari CMS dan juga RCWA, International Living Full Act. It can be concluded to this. Ini. Jadi nyusunnya. Oh my god, wait, salah. Bentar dulu ya. Wait, sorry, let me stop share screen first. Ada masalah technical. Okay, this one. Wait. Jadi habis issue, the regulation is here. Jadi kita susun kayak gini. Issue regulations-nya itu dari yang CMS, terus juga dari yang Internationally Wrongful Act yang kita udah bacain tadi, Rugandi's breach itu keep being repeated and remains not in conformity with the international obligation. Jadi kayak itu tuh udah nge-breach kewajiban internasional dari suatu state karena it keeps happening gitu and there is no change in that kelalaian. And yeah, there abis itu migratory species-nya itu are endangered, kan. Ini info lagi dari yang mood problem also. Terus kita conclude. According to Rugandhi's omissions that were mentioned, Rugandhi has a big role in the causal of barrels inclusion in Appendix 1. Atau according to kelalaian Rugandhi yang berikut, yang telah dimention, Rugandhi itu memiliki peran yang besar dalam bikin barrel ini jadi salah satu spesies yang masuk appendix 1 atau kayak digolong sangat dalam bahaya besar gitu kan. The fact gitu, fakta above violates article 3 of the paragraph 5 dari CMS yang tadi kita baca juga. Then to conclude, due to the facts above, the international obligation of Rugandhi as a party of endangered species was violated. Jadi kurang lebih kayak gitu nyusun buat memo kita kali ini, guys. for the second subtopic, you guys can read it on your own dari link yang udah aku kasih ya, dari chat. Dari link chat Zoom yang udah aku kasih. Thank you guys. You guys can go back to the main room. Oke. Okay? Baca-baca dulu memonya ya.
Thank you Kak Putri.
Nanti juga. Oke, okay, thank you guys. Thank you Ais.
Mawar.
Thank you Mawar.
Oke, halo teman-teman, selamat datang kembali. Kuharap semuanya mungkin udah di main room lagi ya. Gimana nih jadi teman-teman di breakout room-nya? Pastinya seru kan? Ada kakak-kakak SPV-nya, bahas mood problem, nyusun memorial bareng-bareng, dan pastinya mungkin juga diskusi tentang proses reading-nya nanti kayak gimana. Nah, boleh dong di-spill sedikit teman-teman tadi masuk ke breakout room mana dan ngelakuin apa aja. Kira-kira siapa nih yang mau sharing duluan sebelum aku tunjuk? Mungkin bisa raise hand. Kalau belum ada yang inisiatif, aku mau denger dong dari Ais Roselin. Halo Ais, bisa denger suara aku gak?
Bisa.
Oke. Tadi kamu masuk ke breakout room mana, Ais?
Aku tadi di SPV-ku, Kak Mawar.
Oh, berarti aplikan ya?
Iya.
Oh, kira-kira tadi tuh ngelakuin apa aja?
Tadi bahas yang case pertama tentang mural yang dia melakukan penyelewengan terhadap itu mural itu dalam Rogandi gitu. Sekilas seperti itu sih.
Nice. Berarti udah cukup paham dong cara membuat memorial dan proses printing-nya kayak gimana tadi?
Iya, tadi juga sempat bingung sih tentang artikel-artikel gitu, kan harus cari secara detail ya. Tapi tadi udah dibahas secara detail, jadi lebih paham sih sekarang.
Oke, okay, I see. Terima kasih Ais atas jawabannya. Mungkin kita bisa langsung ke acara berikutnya, yaitu oral pairing practice, di mana setelah teman-teman tadi sudah belajar cara menyusun memorial yang baik dan benar, kini saatnya teman-teman untuk mencoba pleading-nya. Nah, untuk kesempatan kayak gini tuh pastinya nggak datang dua kali loh. Jadi, kalian bisa langsung dapat feedback dari juri kita pada oral pleading practice hari ini, yaitu Kak Marinka sendiri. Nah, sebelumnya apakah ada teman-teman yang bersedia untuk menjadi applicant pada sesi oral pleading practice hari ini? kalau dari teman-teman belum ada yang berinisiatif, mungkin aku bisa tunjuk di sini dari Ananda Zahira Lafitiana Rizaldi. Halo Zahira.
Oke, halo Aiga.
Hai Zahira, tadi aku sempat lihat kamu ada di room applicant ya?
Iya, benar banget nih.
Nah, oke. Kalau gitu Zahira bersedia kan jadi applicant buat oral reading practice hari ini?
Bersedia, bersedia.
Oke, sip. Bagus. Kalau gitu, satu lagi tentunya harus siap ya, satu lagi dari responden. Mungkin aku mau nunjuk yang laki-laki. Di sini ada Ananda Sakif Givari. Halo Sakif.
Halo Kak.
Oke, Sakif tadi di responden ya? Oke, kalau gitu Sakif siap dong buat atau bersedia menjadi responden dalam oral reading practice hari ini?
Iya Kak, insyaallah siap.
Oke, bagus. Jadi kalau gitu, karena Zahira dan Sakif sendiri bersedia, kita langsung aja masuk ke dalam sesi oral reading practice. Sebentar. Nah, baik, sebelumnya izinkan saya untuk memberi sedikit arahan bahwa saya sebagai moderator di sini akan memandu menjadi bailiff, dan speaker kita hari ini yaitu Kak Marinka akan menjadi judge-nya pada oral reading hari ini. Tiap applicant dan responden diberikan waktu 5 menit untuk pleading. Nah, oral pleading practice akan saya mulai apabila baik dari applicant, responden, maupun judge sudah siap. Dari teman-teman sendiri, apakah sudah siap? Kak Marinka, apakah ada tambahan sebelum kita dimulai?
Bisa langsung mulai aja.
Oke. Okay. Kalau tidak ada tambahan lagi, mungkin langsung saja kita mulai. The International Court of Justice is now in session. The Honorable President, the case before the court is the case concerning the Ibdu Baral. The applicant and the respondent are each allocated 5 minutes to present their pleadings. The applicant are welcome first to present their pleadings.
Okay, the speaker of applicant, whenever you're ready.
Okay. Good afternoon, Madam President and Your Excellencies. My name is Zahira and will be appealing on the present case on behalf of the applicant, the State of Andhra. I will be submitting our first submission in regards to Rugandi has failed to fulfill the international obligation with regard to the conservation of the barrels. May it please the court. Your Excellencies.
Asian preliminary questions. Why is the court has jurisdiction over your case?
Thank you, Madam President. So the court has need to be clear of this case because the Rugandi has failed to fulfill its international obligation about the conservation of the barrels, because barrels is one of the migratory animals that we need to be protected by the CMS convention.
Continue, Agent.
Thank you, Madam President. Your Excellencies, our first submission would be that Rugandi's Act is contrary to the CMS Convention. In January 2019, the Blue Ship Program was shut down by the government due to the failure of the breeding process. This resulted in the death of 1,000 barrels. The government of Andhra state that the state of Rugandi did not take all necessary measures to protect the barrels. This particular act is a violation of the CMS Convention, Article 2, Paragraph 3, A and B, that explains the parties of this convention
should promote, cooperate in, and support research relating to the migratory species, and shall endeavor to provide immediate protection for migratory species included in Appendix 1. Also, Article 3, Paragraph 5, that explain parties that are range states of a migratory species listed in Appendix 1 shall prohibit the taking of animals belonging to such species. Exceptions may be made to this prohibition only if the taking is for scientific purposes, provided that such exceptions are precise as to contain and limited in space and time. Such taking should not operate to the disadvantage of the species. As they have failed. Yes, Madam President.
Do you have any case law in which certain parties took a protected species, let's say, and use it for a scientific purpose or for research? And what kind of measures do they implement in order for so that the species does not extinct? Do you have any case law, Agent?
I'm sorry, Madam President, I can't assist you with that question right now. May I please continue my submission?
Continue, Agent.
Thank you, Madam President. So as the Rugandi have failed to protect and conduct a scientific purpose that disadvantaged the barrels, so therefore the BBP program is contrary to the CMS convention.
Are there other arguments, Agent?
That could conclude my submission, Madam President, that the BBP program is contrary to the CMS convention. Thank you, and may please the court.
Thank you, Agent. First speaker of the respondent, whenever you're ready.
May it please this honorable court. Madam President and the honorable members of the tribunal, my name is Ahmad Shakib Ghifari. It's my honor to appear before this court. On behalf of the respondent and the state of Rugandi, I will be speaking for the following 5 minutes, supplementing the court that Rugandi has fulfilled its international obligation with regards to the conservation of the barrels itself. Your Excellencies, may I continue?
A preliminary question, Agent. I will ask the same question as I asked before to your opponent. Why has this court should adjudicate your case?
Thank you, Madam President, for the questions. First point, we believe that we claim that because since this is this dispute between two countries and inflicting heavy losses for the both of the countries and resulting to international attention, we believe that this should be under the jurisdiction of International Justice Court or this court. So I think this fulfilled that this case has been under the jurisdiction of this court itself. May I continue?
Continue, Agent.
Thank you, Madam President. So addressing our first submission is that we claim the Rugandi has fulfilled its international obligation with regards to the conservation of the barrel itself. Because first, that we claim Rugandi has not violated the Convention on Migratory Species of the Wild Animals, or CMS. First point, that state of Rugandi had acknowledged the importance of the barrels being conserved by enacted the Rugandi Act for the Barrels Conservation, or RBC. Yes.
The act that you state enacted before enough
to promote the conservation of the barrels. Because as far as the applicant concerned, the use for those barrels might be justified, for example, if it's for scientific purpose or any other purpose as stated in the CMS. So how do you respond to the applicant's submission that you did not violate the CMS?
Oh, thank you, Madam President. This will be included in our second submission or our second point. May I continue for a little bit explaining the furthermore of the second thing?
Answer and then you can continue your argument.
Okay, thank you. According to the question, we answered that the first that CMS permits taking the barrels for the scientific purposes and also for the purpose of inciting the propagation of survival and infected species. We believe this is according to the BPP because since the Rugendi government is actually doing or taking or using the barrels for conservation or research purposes. This is according with the program of the Blue Sheep program or the BPP. And it is accordance to the CMS itself. So by saying that this is unallowed, it actually contradicts with the Blue Sheep program that has been conducted or enacted by the government of the Rugendi. Yes, dear Madam President.
While doing the scientific purpose, do you also promote the conservation of the sparrows as well?
Yes. Yes, Madam President. We believe that we by the Blue Sheep program, we believe that our program, our design, or the purpose of the program are to conserve and repopulate the brahmas population to its the safe level. So one of the purpose of the Blue Sheep program is to save the population. Yes.
And what was the result, Adrian?
We address the fact that a lot of the failure or we address the fact that this program or the Blue Sheep program has received failure itself, that a lot of the animals or the brahmas that has been captured has perished in containment because they are not fit on the containment itself and they're fit in the wild. So a lot of them has perished and died. So therefore, we believe that even though that the program has failed, but at least the problem is at least we try to do this kind of step or this kind of measures to ensure the conservation, even though the final result has not as been effective or as been the purpose of the program, we still at the end tries, Madam President.
What was your justification that you, by trying to promote the conservation itself is enough? In fact, you fail. Don't you think that you, by the value of the program, violate the CMS?
Thank you for the question, Madam President. We claim that by trying our best in this kind of effort and by enacting the Blue Sheep program, we believe that it is still according to the CMS. Why? Because the CMS also are excluding that are excluding that this animal or this brahmas on conservation can be captured and can be used for scientific purposes. Even though at the end they failed, we can still acknowledge that they tried.
I believe your time has enough.
Thank you.
You make
thank you. Okay. Thank you, Your Excellencies. Okay, so by completion of our memorial, we formally address that the state of Rugendi addresses that respectfully request the court to adjust and declare that first, Rugendi has fulfilled its international obligation with regards of the conservation of the barrels. Thank you, may it please the court.
Thank you, agent of the respondent.
Okay, we will now proceed to the judge feedbacks. The honorable card is now adjourned. The judge will now deliberate her feedbacks.
Thank you, moderator. So first, kudos to all of you, applicant and respondent. Very well presentation, indeed. So let's start with the applicants first before I proceed to the respondent, and then I conclude my feedbacks. So for the applicant, I find it hard to understand your arguments, since you did not deliver a clear roadmap on how on the flow of your arguments. So before you start your pleading, it is best to present to the judges first the roadmap. For example, Your Excellencies, in this submission, I will argue that first blah 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 blah, and then I will proceed to my second argument that blah 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 blah. And then you enter into your submission. This will help the judges to understand what kind of arguments you present to the court. And for the others, what I presented to Zahira, the question is the example of a cold bench judges. So the cold bench judges, usually they not giving you lots of questions as I did to the respondent, which is the hot bench judges. It might be fall under certain conditions first, because she wants to pay attention to your presentation as a whole without interrupting, or second, because they did not understand clearly what was your arguments. If the judges ask you lots of questions, it's not because they want to scare you or mereka nggak akan makan kalian. They simply want to guide you on the right track. So if they ask questions, it means that you're on the right track. So you can continue. And then the way you answer, I think you can improve it by remember that you have IREC, you have your outline, and then here in this court, you have a conversation with the judges. So answer it like, and explain your argument like you're explaining something to a 5-year-old kid, for example. Maintain the IREC, keep in mind your outline, maintain your pace, and then answer the question briefly and direct. Be concise of your arguments. Kalau ngejawab sesuatu tuh direct. If the answer is yes, please explain why is it a yes. And if the answer is no, explain as well. That's the example on how to answer a question directly. So if I ask you, for example, do you think that the conduct of the respondent violated CMS, even though they did a scientific research through their program? You answer yes. Why is it a yes? Because blah, 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 blah. You explain directly and concise. And the judges will understand what kind of argument you make, and then the judges will be satisfied if you answer their question directly. Because you have a very limited time. For example, you only have 5 minutes. In a real moot court competition, maybe you only have 20 minutes maximum, and in 20 minutes, you have to bring 2 claims, for example. You cannot bring all the arguments presented in your memorial, and that's why you need a pleading script. The outline consists of the outline. Maybe for now, that's it for the applicant, and then for the respondent. The purpose of being a respondent is that you have to respond to the applicant. You have to pay attention to what the applicant argues. And then you respond to it, because that is your position as a respondent, right? You respond to their argument. They say that you violate a certain treaty. Respond to it. Respond that you're not violating that treaty. And same goes for the respondent. Please answer the questions directly. And be concise of your arguments. Remember the IREC, remember the outline, and maintain your pace. Don't speak too fast, don't speak too slow. Just speak like you're having a conversation, that's it. And as for the general feedback, please pay attention to manners. This is an international court of justice. Manner is very, very important. You have to sit like this, duduk tegak, and then your eyes straight to the camera, and then you use formal words. For example, Madam President and Your Excellencies, we argue that blah, 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 blah. We, instead of saying we submit or we believe, try to say that we argue. We know that you're submitting to this court. You say we argue, or this rule stated that blah, 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 blah. And then, please, kalau misalnya in a real moot court competition, duduk tenang. Jangan tiba-tiba maju ke sana, ke sini. Jangan gerak-gerak, matanya jangan kemana-mana. It's important to maintain your position as formal as possible. And then for the introduction, you don't have to give us a long introduction. Just simply say, Madam President and Your Excellencies, my name is, for example, my name is Jahira, and I will be speaking for the respondent side. I will argue about first blah, 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 blah. May it please the court. Continue. No need to make a whole long introduction because you have a very limited time. You only have 20 minutes. If you spend 1 minute just to introduce yourself, you only have 90 minutes to present your argument. Bear in mind that sometimes judges will ask a very, very long question, so you will have to pay attention to that, okay? And then for answering the questions, please avoid saying, well, Your Excellencies, or okay, no. Just simply answer the question. No need to say, thank you, Your Excellencies, for the question. That would be such a waste of time. Just answer them. That's all they need as a judge. I think that's all of my feedback. Any questions from the oralists or from the audience as well?
Well, I have a question, if I may.
Yes, please.
Oh, okay, thank you. Thank you for the feedback as a general, but I have a couple of questions. First, that I see a lot of work that is being criticized or being corrected, but a lot of things that I see in moot court competition that this kind of words are being used, like, for instance, in AML Courts Commission Arford, International Committee of AMR or AML, I think. So there's the use of well or well necessarily no, and there's like we are talking to a 5-year-old. When you're talking to a 5-year-old, you cannot use a very high definition or high class words because simply they cannot understand. And a lot of the vocabularies that we have are the vocabularies that we talk to our friends. And the question is, how do we use the words that we're supposed to use and sound it both understanding and both and classy at the same time? Kind of like, that's the question.
Okay, so basically the phrase like explaining things, please explain to the judges like the judges was a 5-year-old kid, is means that you have to be clear, and you have to deliver your argument precisely. Be concise. That's karena anak umur 5 tahun itu kan biasanya perlu dijelasin kayak a very comprehensive explanation. And that's true. You don't need to use bahasa-bahasa aneh yang kalian bikin di memo kalian. No, don't need to use that. Just use a formal word, but both of you and the judges could understand the word. Jadi kalau misalnya di memo kan suka ada bahasa-bahasa yang aneh tuh, bahasa-bahasa yang susah. Is it because maybe you rephrase the sentence, or it's because of what the court say in their judgment, for example? No need to use that in your oral opinion. Just simply use a formal word, tapi nggak usah yang aneh-aneh. Like, a basic vocabulary will be okay. Tapi, ingat lagi, This is the International Court of Justice. You have to be formal. While explaining to the judges, treat them as your colleague, not bukan orang yang apa ya. Don't treat them like them. Mereka tuh kayak, oh, they're so scary. I don't know how to explain. And then you use all those unnecessary words, all those words that you use in a memorial. Don't do that. Yeah, just simply engage with the judge. Karena engagement ini penting gitu loh. So if the judge is comfortable with your argument, they will eventually take your side. Otherwise, they will take your opponent's side. Gitu. So you have to choose your words carefully. Remember, no need to use kata-kata yang sulit, kata-kata yang mungkin jarang ditemukan. No, just use words you use in a regular conversation, but bear in mind to apa ya, buat ngebawa kata, buat merangkai kata-kata itu sehingga jadi bakal jadi a formal presentation. Gitu satu. That choosing the words is very tricky, karena while you plead your case to the court, you have to make sure that the words that you use itu nggak backfire ke kamu. You don't, kamu nggak gali kuburan sendiri. You're not digging your own grave. Jadi, that is something every muters learn. Mau mulai dari awal, bahkan sampai kita nggak muti lagi, we have to learn that. Because that will be very tricky. But I hope that it helps. Karena jangan bingung sama phrase yang kayak you have to explain to judges like the judges themselves or a 5-year-old kid. That itu kayak cuma ungkapan doang. Don't take it seriously, okay? I've heard from several judges too. And satu lagi, itu satu.
Baik, sebelumnya mohon maaf karena keterbatasan waktu sehingga closing statement-nya harus dicukupkan. Terima kasih Kak Marinka untuk feedback yang telah diberikan dan juga para peserta, terutama Sakif dan Zahira yang telah berani maju untuk melakukan oral pleading. Diharapkan teman-teman sudah memahami dengan baik cara penyusunan memorial dan juga pleading-nya. Saya selaku moderator akan memaparkan sedikit kesimpulan dari materi yang telah disampaikan. Memorial merupakan suatu berkas yang berisi argumen yang meyakinkan the court bahwa pihak kalianlah yang berhak untuk menang melalui uraian fakta dan hukum yang disajikan. Tiga bagian penting dari memorial adalah facts, law, and argument. Memorial yang baik sesungguhnya akan mengacu pada konsep IRAC, yaitu issue, regulation, application, and conclusion. Selain itu, penting bagi delegates untuk mengingat tujuan dari argumen itu sendiri, maka sebaiknya menggunakan kalimat yang bersifat persuasif. Sebelum pleading berlangsung, umumnya delegates harus sudah menyiapkan outline atau roadmap yang berisi poin-poin argumen, legal standing, yurisdiksi dari kasusnya, fakta, dan juga pengetahuan umum tentang international law untuk disampaikan. Terakhir, pentingnya manners dan flexibility selama pleading. Therefore, practice makes perfect. Jadi dengan latihan yang konsistenlah, teman-teman akan mendapatkan outcome yang sesuai dan yang diharapkan. Sekian pemaparan materi pada hari ini. Semoga dapat bermanfaat bagi seluruh peserta yang telah hadir. Untuk acara selanjutnya akan saya kembalikan kepada MC. Saya selaku moderator pamit undur diri. Mohon maaf apabila terdapat kesalahan selama acara berlangsung dan terima kasih.
Terima kasih Aiga karena telah memandu agenda inti acara IMCC Class hari ini. Terima kasih juga kepada para partisipan yang masih hadir dan mengikuti acara hingga saat ini. Dan jangan lupa para peserta untuk mengisi daftar hadir yang sudah dikirimkan oleh panitia di kolom chat box. Oke, sebelum kita sampai ke agenda akhir acara, akan dilaksanakan penyerahan sertifikat kepada speaker sebagai wujud apresiasi dari ILSA Chapter Universitas Brawijaya. Penyerahan sertifikat ini akan saya pandu bersama dengan Kaila selaku Project Officer untuk melakukan penyerahan.
Baik, terima kasih Irsyad. Untuk kemarin kan mengucapkan terima kasih sudah meluangkan waktunya dan sudah mau untuk membagikan ilmunya mengenai IMCC. Di sini kami akan menyerahkan sertifikat sebagai bentuk apresiasi kami. Oke, untuk operator boleh diabadikan ya.
Oke, aku hitung ya. 1, 2, 3. Okay, udah. Thank you.
Thank you, Kayla, and thank you, Yelsa Chapter Ubay, for having me today.
Okay, sekali lagi terima kasih.
Semoga ilmunya bermanfaat buat semua ya.
Oke, terima kasih Kak Marinta. Aku kembalikan ke Irsyad ya.
Oke. Sebelum kita akhiri, akan diadakan sesi foto bersama melalui screenshot layar Zoom yang akan dilakukan oleh panitia. Bagi para peserta yang belum mengaktifkan kameranya, untuk segera diaktifkan kameranya karena kita akan melakukan sesi foto bersama. Dan kepada panitia bertugas, dipersilakan.
Oke, sebelumnya, apa masih ada yang mau on-cam? Silakan. Udah ya, aku hitung. 1, 2, 3. Oke, sekali lagi. 1, 2, 3. Oke, sudah. Thank you.
Oke, dengan berakhirnya acara sesi dokumentasi menandakan akhir dari acara ini, kami mengucapkan terima kasih kepada para speakers dan juga antusias para peserta pada event IMCC kelas ini. Kami pun sangat menunggu kehadiran teman-teman di acara ILSA lainnya, salah satunya IMCC Exposure Intention, yang akan dilaksanakan dengan sistem talk show. Materi yang akan diberikan menyangkut hal-hal negosiasi dan segala hal yang dipersiapkan dalam mengikuti perlombaan Intention. Sekali lagi kami mengucapkan terima kasih atas kehadiran teman-teman. Saya mewakili seluruh komite mengucapkan mohon maaf apabila terdapat kesalahan maupun kekurangan selama proses acara berlangsung. Terima kasih. Akhir kata, wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom, Om Santi 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 Om, Namo Buddhaya. ILSA, the future of international law.